A local bar was so sure that its bartender was the strongest man around that they offered a standing $1,000 bet. The bartender would squeeze a lemon until all the juice ran into a glass, and then hand the lemon to somebody else, and anyone who could squeeze out more than one drop of juice then would win the money. Lots of people had tried, but nobody had been able to do it. Well, one day this squatty little guy comes in, and he's wearing thick glasses and a polyester suit. And in this tiny, squeaky little voice, he says, "I'd like to try that bet." So after the laughter died down, the bartender said, "Okay," and he grabbed a lemon and he squeezed away, and then he handed the wrinkled remains to this little man. And everybody was laughing, but suddenly it got silent because he started to squeeze the lemon and he got 6 drops of lemon juice out of it. So the crowd cheered, the bartender gave him $1,000, and as he did, he said, "What do you do for a living? Are you a lumberjack or a weightlifter or something?" He said, "No, I work for the IRS." Anyway, so Zacchaeus is a tax collector. And his encounter with Jesus is one of the best known biblical stories around. It's only in the book of Luke, which is interesting. Most of these well-known stories are usually more than one of our gospels. It's such a human story, isn't it? A short man, he's trying to see Jesus, he can't see, so he scrambles up in a tree. And as I said earlier, you know, some of us are pretty clear about what this looks like, not being able to see parades or movies or concerts. And so we can identify with what the Bible says. You know, he wanted to see Jesus, but being a short man, he couldn't because of the crowd. But the story isn't just a nursery rhyme, you know, it's not just a little jingle that we teach the kids. It's really a powerful, provocative story. It introduces the very radical notion that God will stop at nothing else than the total transformation of who we are. So Zacchaeus lived in Jericho, which was a veritable Eden. You know, it's like an oasis of date palms and balsam groves. They exported products all over the known world at the time. There was a day when Mark Anthony had presented Jericho as a gift to Cleopatra with Arabia thrown in. And it lay along the caravan routes. So it was a beehive of commercial and human activity. Zacchaeus was the chief tax collector for the Roman government in this prosperous city. He probably had a staff of collectors, and he was probably the most hated man in Jericho. For a couple of reasons. One, he worked for the occupying forces, right? And so he was regarded as a traitor among his own people. And he and his cohorts could stop anybody in Jericho and assess duties on whatever they had in their possession. So if somebody was driving a cart, for instance, they could be taxed for each wheel on the cart, the animal that was pulling it, and all the goods that were in it. So when he was done with his collections, he would send a portion, whatever he had agreed to send, into the Roman government. We talked a little bit about this last week because we were talking about another tax collector. So this system was ripe for abuse because he got to keep everything that he didn't have to give to the government. When the passage in the Bible says he was wealthy, it was an indictment, right? We weren't celebrating. He had accumulated his wealth in service to the invaders at the expense of his country. And he was regarded by them as human filth. Zacchaeus, whose name actually meant pure one or righteous one, had turned his name into a sneer on the lips of his brothers and sisters. He was a standing joke, and the mention of his name brought nothing but disgust. So for him, the money was nice, I'm sure, but he lived as an outcast among his own people. No one to call a friend. No social life, no involvement with others except those who wanted to use him because of his money. It had to be a pretty lonely and depressing existence. about Jesus. He knows that in the stories Jesus tells, the tax collector can be the hero and the Pharisee can be, you know, the foil. We heard that last week. And you can see that in that story that we talked about last week, that Jesus has a way of flipping things around, right? This Jesus comes into town with a reputation for being comfortable with those who are on the fringes of society, children and women, and those who have been rejected by their own culture. And they can find in Jesus this listening ear and this warm reception. So I think Zacchaeus just thought, this might be worth a listen, right? It might be worth checking this guy out. But it turned out that was easier said than done, because Zacchaeus was short, and seeing over or through the crowd was a real chore. And I suspect as he made his way through the crowd, he probably got a couple jabs and maybe got tripped a couple times, because people didn't like him at all. So the only way for him to see Jesus then was to run ahead and climb up in a tree, I guess hide in the branches. I don't know what he expected to see. I don't know what he expected to have happen. But it was a pretty amazing thing that did happen, right? Jesus stopped this huge parade of people walking through Jericho. Jesus stopped and he looked up in the tree and he saw Zacchaeus. And he said, Zacchaeus, come down here immediately because I'm going to your house today. And it says that Zacchaeus just scrambled right down and then he welcomed him gladly. I'm sure he did, you know. I bet not too many people came calling on Zacchaeus. I bet house guests were pretty rare in his home. Now, he could have stayed up in the tree, right, and just rebuffed Jesus' invitation. Plenty of people do that every day. It's certainly easier, isn't it, to just go on with life as it is, stay busy with our own agendas, than to allow Jesus in, to have lunch with us, to delve into our inner core, right? It's risky business to allow someone like that into the part of us where our truest self resides. Most of us resist. But Zacchaeus takes this chance and invites Jesus in to explore his home and his heart. And it must have been a lunch to remember. Now this was a real bitter pill for the townsfolk, if you can imagine. What kind of so-called Messiah would even acknowledge, much less go to their house and eat, with the most notorious sinner in town? Luke says they began to, you know, murmur and mutter and grumble, and I bet they did, and plenty more. The thing that we don't know is we don't know what really happened at Zacchaeus' house. What we see are the results, and the results tell us a lot. Because Zacchaeus makes a two-pronged pledge to give half of his yearly income to the poor and to return anything he stole from anybody four times over. Now, Jewish law would require him to make restitution of any money he stole plus 20%. But he decided to give 400%. Something in that encounter with Jesus changed the way Zacchaeus saw the world. Now he could see people in need instead of seeing people he needed to please. I think that might be one of the most dangerous things that Jesus does to us. He changes how we see other people. And all of a sudden, these labels that we like so much don't work quite as well. You know, rich and poor and Democrat and Republican and black and white and Hispanic and gay and straight. Now we see real people with real people's needs, like us. We can no longer turn a blind eye to a hurting world, and we rally to support neighbors and strangers without concern for their social status or their skin. That's what it is to see with the eyes of Jesus. Salvation comes to Zacchaeus' house. He is forever changed from a taker to a giver. He's made his living taking from people. And suddenly, after one meal with Jesus, right, he's giving his money away like he's the United Way of Jericho. sure I've seen this time and time again, you know, when Jesus takes up residence in somebody's life, they become generous. Somehow, Jesus loosens our grip on our wallet and our time and our pocketbooks and credit cards. Giving becomes an opportunity and not just a requirement. I even go so far as to suggest that a generous heart is always the result of an authentic encounter with the living Christ. You don't need to tell me how much love you have for Jesus. You can just show me your tax returns and your charitable donations. You can tell me how you spend your free time and how you plan your retirement. If it's all about you and your self-serving life, then you probably need to invite Jesus over for lunch. As a result of that encounter with Jesus, for Zacchaeus, a 50% tithe seemed an appropriate response. Think what shape the church would be in if we did that. Paul Shearer, in describing this story, says that this meeting with Jesus redeemed Zacchaeus' past, it transformed his present, and it redirected his future. And isn't that what God wants to do for us? You know, this is the story of the power of the grace of God. To genuinely change human needs. It's a rare thing. You know, his change, no doubt, cost Zacchaeus' job. And there's a somewhat dubious tradition that Zacchaeus later became the bishop of Caesarea, which I don't know if it's true or not. It's a nice ending if it is. But this is more than a nursery rhyme or a nursery room story. This is the story of Zacchaeus and a powerful story of change. It's only found in Luke, like I said, but it turns out to be this kind of reproduction in miniature of the mission of Jesus, right? Received by the outcast, condemned by the authorities, and then all that muttering and murmuring that goes on that follows him all the way to Jerusalem. It starts with a little man in a tree, and it ends with the biggest heart Jesus encounters in all of Israel. Jesus is coming to town. He has an agenda to seek and save the lost and to change the world one person at a time. So I would invite you to climb a tree and watch to see what he's up to. But I want to warn you, because he might just stop beneath the tree where you are, where you sit, no matter how comfortable or complacent or secure or even immobile you've become. And he might just look at you and invite you down, right? And down to fellowship with him, down to an opportunity to be transformed. It takes courage to get out of that tree. But the gift of a new vision and the reordering of priorities would make it worth it. In the end, Jesus declares that salvation has come to the house of Zacchaeus, that he too is a son of Abraham. I don't know what came first, if Zacchaeus was already a son of Abraham, or if in his transformation, Jesus then declares him a son of Abraham. But we do know that he was lost for just a bit. He got confused about why he was here and whom he was here to serve, just like you and me sometimes, right? But thank God that Jesus always comes looking